Devim Saraswatim Vyasam,
Devim Saraswatim
Sarasvatim Vyasam
Gato Jayam Mudiraye
Gato Jayam Mudiraye.
Before reciting Srimad Bhagavatam, which is our very means of conquest, I first offer respectful obeisances to the personality of Godhead Lord Narayan, one to the nine minor rishis, the proposed human being, Mother Sarasvati, Goddess of Learning, and Srila Vyasadeva, the author. By regular attendance in classes on the Bhagavad, and by rendering service to the pure devotees, all that is troublesome within the heart becomes destroyed to practically nil. And thus, loving service unto the glorious Lord, who is praised with transcendental mind, becomes established in the realm of the whole family. And let's see, we're reading from the 15th chapter of the first canto, and it's text number 39 today.
Patim tataha
Prajapatyam nirupyastim
Agnin apivad ishvaraha
Agnin apivad ishvaraha.
Agni
Abhivarishvara
मत्पुर्याय पावकम्
सुरसेनापतिं ततः प्रजापत्यं निरूयेष्टिम् अग्ने अपि पारीश्वरः मथुरायां तथा वाजाम् सुरसेनां पतिं ततः प्रजापत्यं निरूयेष्टिम्
King of the Surasenas.
Thereafter.
Prajapatyam.
Prajapatya sacrifice.
Nirupya.
Having performed.
Ishtim.
Gold.
Agnin.
Fire.
Apibad.
Placed in himself.
Ishwaraha.
Capable. This is about Yudhisthira. I forget who's speaking though. So, let's see. Translation. Then he posted Vrajra, the son of Aniruddha, grandson of Lord Krishna, at Mathura as the king of Surasena. Afterwards, Maharaj Yudhisthira performed a Prajapatya sacrifice and placed in himself the fire for quitting household life. Please repeat. Then he posted Vajra, the son of Aniruddha, in brackets, the grandson of Lord Krishna,
at Mathura,
is the king of Surasena. Afterwards, Maharaj Yudhisthira performed a Prajapatya sacrifice.
Performed a Prajapatya sacrifice.
And placed in himself. The fire for quitting household life. Srila Prabhupada's divine purport. Maharaj Yudhisthira, after placing Maharaj Parikshit on the imperial throne of Hastinapura, and after posting Vrajra, the great grandson of Lord Krishna, as the king of Mathura, accepted the renounced order of life. The system of four orders of life and four castes in terms of quality and work, known as Vana Ashram Dharma, is the beginning of real human life. And Maharaj Yudhisthira is the protector of this system of human activities, timely retired from active life as a sannyasi, handing over the charge of the administration to a trained prince, Maharaj Parikshit. The scientific system of Varna Ashram Dharma divides the human life into four divisions of occupation and four orders of life. The four orders of life is brahmacharya, grihastha, vanaprastha, and sannyasi, or to be followed by all, irrespective of the occupational division. Modern politicians Do not wish to retire from active life, even if they are old enough. But Yudhisthira Maharaj is an ideal king, voluntarily retired from active administrative life to prepare himself for the next life. Everyone's life must be so arranged that the last stage of life, say at least the last 15 to 20 years prior to death, can be absolutely devoted to the devotional service of the Lord to attain the highest perfection of life. It is really foolish to engage oneself all the days of one's life in material enjoyment and fruitive activity, because as long as the mind remains absorbed in fruitive work for material enjoyment, there is no chance of getting out from conditioned life or material bondage. No one should follow the suicidal policy of neglecting one's supreme task of attaining the highest perfection of life, namely, going back home, back to Godhead. Thus ends the purport to the 39th verse of the 15th chapter, the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. There's some sweets that this Krishna Shaya Prabhu can pass on. It's probably a lot more than the little audience we have, but everybody can take as many as they want. There's Ladu on the right and Bertie on the left.
And government in the middle.
And then when he brings me that bag, I'll send around the new BTG and an old BTG from 2011 and one from 2010. One from 2010 is something about where medicine blends with devotion, so we would be interested in that. This is the new one. These are the two old ones. People can entertain themselves with that. I offer my humble and respectful obeisances to Srila Prabhupada, who has opened my eyes, although they will certainly shut by the darkness of ignorance. When Guru Goswami Prabhupada, who has established within the material world the mission to fulfill the desire of Lord Chaitanya, give me shelter under his lotus feet. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So, it's our duty to try to bring the same message that Srila Prabhupada is communicating to the world. He, for lack of thinking about what language to use, he sort of ridiculed Mahatma Gandhi Prabhu for staying in office so long. And even the history of Srila Prabhupada writing him a letter telling him that, you know, he should retire and take to the preaching of Lord Krishna's Gita. And the Mahatma didn't. We don't know if he even got the letter, but shortly after that is when he was assassinated. So, you know, people get pretty riled up about religion and politics. And to the extent that assassinations are quite frequent. And in religious groups, we see that there's often fractions and splits because people get so riled up over particular issues. So generally there's not an assassination, there's just a split. And they go off and form some other organization, or they just don't attend there anymore. So Srila Prabhupada, he's suggesting that, you know, people try to be a little bit more transcendental to our situation in this world and simply retire to free ourselves from sense gratification and fruitive activity. Now we can maybe understand that in the political realm. It may be a little bit harder to understand in the religious realm, because in the religious realm you would think that people are 100% doing their best to serve God. And that is devotional service, that is Krishna consciousness, when one is purely surrendering the Supreme Personality of Godhead, considering oneself the Lord's servant, and acting constantly on his behalf to render some service to him. And to some degree that's true, but then, you know, it's also very individualistic. You know, a person may be simply religious, but, you know, their heart may be filled with ambition for material opulence, material desire. And in that way, it's not really pure devotional service. It's mixed devotional service. A person is rendering some service to Guru and Krishna, but with a motive to achieve a certain opulence or a certain position or a certain happiness, whatever it may be. So, consequently, you can have a church or a temple full of devotees who are materially motivated. And there may be just a few who aren't, or there may be none. And the minister himself, the priest, may be materially motivated. Someone told the story recently, I can't remember who, of the Brahmin. I think Gokula recited the story that Jayakatai Maharaj told. One Brahmin who was haunting a house. And the people questioned him where he was staying, and he told them in the house. They told him about how the house is haunted by a Brahma Rakshasa. And Bhaktivinoda said, "I'll just chant Hare Krishna." And they said, "What's a Brahma Rakshasa?" And then he asked, about the priest at the temple, and they said, "Oh, he wasn't a very good character, but he always chanted Hare Krishna." And so Bhaktivinoda said, "Well, that wasn't pure chanting." And they said, "Well, how can he be liberated?" And Thakur said, "When he hears pure chanting from a pure devotee, he can become liberated." You know, Bhaktivinoda had said that, you know, one could chant for, a lot of lines. I can't remember the number. I don't know if it was millions or thousands, but, you know, it was like an awful lot. And one would never become, never go back home to Godhead by such chanting. So then, Bhaktivinoda actually went and spent the night there, and when the Brahma Rakshasa trying to haunt them, he simply chanted Hare Krishna, and the Brahma Rakshasa was never heard from again. So all the people, they thought, "Wow, he must have been the pure devotee that recited the mantra that the Brahmin heard and was able to, lead that ghostly existence." So that's the power of chanting Hare Krishna, purely. But Srila Prabhupada is making the point here that if we can just put aside the mundane before we die, and he's suggesting 15, 20 years even, and just devote ourselves fully to trying to be purely Krishna conscious, to, preparing for our next life, preparing for going back home to Godhead, that may take a lot of intellectual debating within our own mind. You know, we may tell ourselves how nice it is back home in Godhead, but our attachments may tell us how much we want to enjoy such and such life in this world. And that constant debate may go on with ourselves. And, you know, even if one chooses some life in this universe, or, you know, universe like this, in the material universe, then at least by being Krishna conscious, one can be assured of, an opulent birth, or, you know, a birth where one is taken care of. Krishna says in the Gita, in an aristocratic family, or in a Brahmin family, or in a rich person's family, where one had, ample opportunity to practice Krishna consciousness, to be, educated. Now, there may be different types of education. One may be born in some rich Malechian Dhavana family and be educated like Hirani Kashipu wanted to educate Brahma. But one may be born in some Brahmin family and be given all sorts of Vedic education. May learn Sanskrit from the time they're born and learn how to chant the proper meters for the mantras. And, in this way become fully educated before, they're even old enough to marry. So that's generally the Vedic system, is that one's trained as a brahmachari when they're young, so that they can develop good character, strong character. And then when they take up their grihastha life, they'll be able to remember Krishna and, ultimately be able to renounce that. We even see in the life of Ajaniya, because he was properly trained, even though he had lived most of his life, is a very attached and even a sinful and criminal grihastha. Still, at the end of life, he reformed. So that's the power of, proper training. Now, for those of us who may have missed the case, because after all, the Krishna consciousness movement is for the first time in history. When Srila Prabhupada arrived in New York, practically speaking, it is being spread amongst the Malechis and the Yavanis, those people who had no Vedic culture. They have some, religious culture that allows the sacrifice of animals or the eating of animals. And, to some degree, contest, Vedic knowledge and, propounds and espouses its own views of the absolute truth. And, there is some system of morality there, and it can be more strict or less strict depending on the organization or the group of people that are practicing. So, Prabhupada brings it to our part of the world, and we see that Krishna consciousness flourishes, but another point that I wanted to make is regard, but it,
I'm talking about the training.
Yeah, so we didn't necessarily have any Vedic training. There had been some religious training there, which is certainly helpful, but it, may not be exactly Vedic. So Prabhupada would say better late than never. Better we just take up Krishna consciousness. And we see that a lot of old people do that. It may be harder, but they take it up, they throw themselves into reading the books. Some are even already retired. That they'll sit there and they'll study and they'll underline so many things, in every chapter, and they'll pore over these things. And in this way, they talk to devotees about it, and to actually transform their consciousness. And someone who dies in that state of consciousness, then Krishna promises in the Gita that they will attain to a state like his own. So that's the important thing, is to actually take the opportunity when one is older. There's less possibility of enjoying sense gratification. The body just is not as capable. And, we're less capable of working and, being given some big responsible position, because of old age. And, and people generally don't have a tendency to want to pay you much because, they're not going to get so much work out of you. So then one can just take the opportunity to try to be Krishna conscious, to try to develop a good relationship with Krishna, and then who could be a better, advisor or a better counselor, a better friend, a person that we can sit there and discuss our future with. Krishna is certainly the best one to do that with. If one is really sincere and doing their best to understand and be Krishna conscious and trying to work out all of the knots of material existence, the things that we are bound to, and just placing it all at Krishna's lotus feet, then certainly Krishna can make the proper arrangements for us, whatever that may be. He will know best. We're just surrendering to him. It's not that we necessarily know what to do. We're just surrendering to him. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the 14th chapter, I think the second to last verse, I'm not 100% sure it is, one verse where Srila Prabhupada says in the first book that a person may not be so well educated in Krishna consciousness, but if they just have the tendency to surrender, take shelter, then Krishna can make all arrangements. And in the 10th chapter, there's also that verse where the Lord says that if they're devoted to him, then Krishna will provide. There's another verse, provide
with their eyes. Care what they lack, deserve what they have.
There's that verse there also. So it's the important thing is the connection with Krishna. And that's the grace of the pure devotee coming in line with the disciplic succession. Their gift to the world is that they're simply trying to give Krishna, and they're trying to engage people in Krishna's service. And that's another a dramatic feature of devotional service. That when the pure devotee just engages the fool and the rascal in devotional service, then the devotional service is so purifying that the fool and the rascal can even become a pure devotee. So it's not that one has to start from the beginning of the Vana and ashram system even, which can be a very long system of training. One can simply surrender to the devotee or the pure devotee in line of the disciplic succession and follow his order. And that way, very quickly, one can become free from all of the bad habits and materialistic desires that haunt us and take up the science of pure devotional service. Srila Prabhupada proved that again and again. With so many disciples, they had no qualification, but because they would just surrender to him and follow his orders, then either quickly or slowly, they took to the path of Krishna consciousness. And that's the ultimately the most important thing in life. And the Sri Srimad Bhagavatam, the second chapter, the first canto, has that famous verse that says, what good is one's occupational duties if they don't bring about an attraction for Krishna? If somehow ever we're just so wrapped up in the world, even if we may be expert in our vana, in ashram, but we have no attraction for the message of Krishna somehow ever, then, you know, what good is such expert materialistic work? It is simply, you know, bonding us to this world. Or, you know, one is so foolish they don't even know about the opportunity to leave this world of birth and death, where, you know, Mother Durga is a very tough master, and, you know, any little mistake we make, we have to severely pay for. But this is the world we remain attached to, the world of Devi Dham, just serving this world of Maya for, you know, for sense gratification, basically. You know, somehow or other, you know, our mind is just wrapped around enjoying the senses in different capacities. And, you know, we're willing to serve here till again and again, you know, no limit of time. So how one can change that alliance, and it's a very strong alliance, just like, you know, people have an alliance to their country, you know, whether they're Iranian or American or Egyptian or Indian, you know, they're all very nationalistic, you know, due to the bodily conception of life. So also due to this bodily conception of life, you know, we're very attached to serving the David, maybe even being a Deva, serving, you know, Goddess Durga and Father Shiva, or even Surya. And, you know, we're even very proud of that. And so that way we don't escape because we're very attached. So to make that escape, you know, one has to hear the science of Krishna consciousness from the pure devotee and become attached after to Krishna's world. You know, that takes some, you know, like we do every day during Srimad Bhagavatam, then we, you know, we can build up that attachment. You know, why live in this world getting these material bodies, even if it may be a body like Brahma or Indra or Varuna, when we can have a completely spiritual body that is of a much higher caliber. It, you know, it never grows old, it never dies, it never suffers from some kind of disease. But it's actually existing in a realm that is always full of joy. There's never any demoniac activity or the threat of some sort of culprits taking over. There's no having to manage poor conditioned living entities who are suffering from karma and have to go to the court of Yamaraj. We don't have to no longer worry about them. We can completely be existing in a world that is completely transcendental. And Krishna at any time can wake up anyone. You know, this world is completely temporary. And Vishnu is Vishnu, he'll breathe it in. And when he wants to create it again, he'll give everybody their chance to again, you know, come back home, back to Godhead. But obviously, this is our chance. Or, you know, we wouldn't have heard about it. So we need to take advantage of that, and just hearing about great devotees like Yudhisthira, how they can take off those clothes, because sometimes the clothes we wear, it goes along with the job. You know, just like sport figures have certain clothes, you know, people even, you know, even purchase these clothes with their autograph on it. So, you know, and you see the way people dress with different occupations. Military people always have certain uniforms. And, you know, and the president, you know, they expect to dress in a certain way according to their country. Otherwise, know, it's, they would probably make more of a thing about the person, the way he dressed, than sometimes even what they said. Because it's a reflection on the whole country, and they just expect a certain thing out of a certain person. So Yudhisthira Maharaj, you know, he took off those clothes. You know, he took them off. And you see in Sanatana Goswami's life that Lord Chaitanya was very pleased when he gave up the nice charter that his brother-in-law had given him. Lord Chaitanya actually became pleased. And then he renounced such a nice thing. So Yudhisthira Maharaj, you know, he took off the type of garb that the Rajarshi, the emperor, was wearing. And, you know, he turned it all over to the prince. The prince had been, you know, properly trained and was certainly qualified. He just turned it over to him. And his mind became detached from it all. He wasn't going to put it on again. It was over. That life was over. He had done his thing for Krishna. No. What to speak of if we didn't do it for Krishna, then, you know, she'd also put it aside. You know, he actually just put it aside, even though he was so Krishna conscious, he put it aside. And he, you know, he went off like a mendicant. Now we don't, it's not recommended that type of sannyas, where one just goes in the forest, but, you know, that does make the point of being giving up sense gratification and just fixing one's consciousness on Krishna. That's, you know, we're not very capable of that type of performance. You know, we're very lucky that, you know, Srila Prabhupada created for us a society and temples whereby we can really involve ourselves in all the devotional practices where, you know, no longer do we pay any interest in politics and entertainment and so many other things, economic development. But here we know we spend our time trying to hear about Krishna when one would actually completely, you know, just renounce everything. So then what do you do? Well, you hear about Krishna and the association of devotees. That goes on an awful lot in most of his kind of temples, even if they're small. But in the bigger ones, there's always some type of hearing and chanting going on. And we do our best to remember what we hear and chant. And then we have the opportunity to do some puja. Where else can people do that? I mean, that's monopolized by Brahmins. It's a monopoly. I mean, you have to go through certain schools. You know, not anybody can get to do it. You have to be a very special person. Sometimes you have to be born in a certain family. No one can get to do it. You know, you can just kind of do it at home. But then, again, you're alone unless you have a small community of devotees. But in this kind, everyone can get that opportunity, you know, to actually become a Brahmin, a Pujari. You know, one is very fortunate. No one, not many people have the opportunity to offer puja. Even in this kind, it's difficult because, you know, they expect that, you know, one is following the regulative principles. And then one has to have these initiations. And the initiation system just gets harder and harder. I mean, now somebody told me that to take second initiation, you have to take the Bhakti Shastri test. And that was just a year ago, that wasn't a requirement. So, I mean, they're making it like harder and harder. It used to be that a person could take sannyas if a sannyasi would give them initiation. Not anymore, not this time. I mean, you're like on this list for like a decade or more, generally speaking. So it's not that it's easy, but still, in another sense, it is fairly easy. One can move into a temple, and then immediately, you know, you have to, you know, eat with the devotees. They're eating. You know, you have to wake up when they're waking up. You can immediately start helping the pujaris, and, you know, then the devotees help you through the initiation process. One can become a pujari. Before, an old person is renouncing, they have really no care of any. You're just trying to surrender to Krishna. And whatever the devotees give you to do is fine. So, you know, one can offer puja. Or one can try to always be serving Krishna and his devotees. one could be trying to make some sacrifice for Krishna, or trying to surrender everything to Krishna. Or, you know, serving Krishna and Krishna's devotees' lotus feet. In this way, the whole non-devotional practices can be implemented according to one's needs, the need of somebody. Now, that type of sannyas is more highly recommended. That, you know, that will actually involve our minds more easily in Krishna consciousness. But what, going to the forest alone, probably will get sick. You know, we won't be able to focus on Krishna because of ailment. And God knows what we're going to remember. We don't have nobody around us. But, you know, that type of sannyas was for, you know, people that had other types of qualifications. It's just not recommended at all. We can speak of people who have not even been really seriously trained for that type of renunciation. You know, better that we throw ourselves into trying to help Srila Prabhupada's society, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, which is, you know, made up of so many temples and forms and different types of ministries, and, you know, and take up, you know, doing what we can to assist the devotees to make it all work for the good of mankind. You know, then there's what's his name? Guru Karuna told that lady in the Walmart that, you know, Krishna can pick us up by our sika. Because it's only in ISKCON, you know, generally speaking, not only in ISKCON, but at least in the Western world, it's only in ISKCON, where, you know, people have sikas. I mean, you know, when people come here, they work serving full time, they're just not part time and visiting. You know, we tell them, you know, why are you keeping long hair as you're serving full time here? You should shave up. You know, that's our process of renunciation. That's what Prabhupada told us, you know. I mean, what is the big deal of sacrificing some hair? You know, and we may think that, oh, it's just some sort of renunciation that it has no significance. But it actually has so much significance in Vedic culture that no one could perform a fire sacrifice without a sika. You know, Brahmins had to have a sika. That was in the days of yore, you know. So it's a very significant thing, actually. Then, you know, even putting on tilak. I mean, where else are people going to tell you to put on tilak? So, you know, the coming to, that's the type of, you know, we'd love to have somebody like Yudhisthira Maharaj, you know, give up everything in the world and just come to the temple and surrender to the temple and want to just serve. That would be, you know, fantastic. You can imagine the potency of service that would happen. But in the meantime, it's like a it's like a grand prize that we have just as much service as we want. Transcendental service. As much as we can delve into, we can be trying to remember Krishna. And, you know, it's such, you know, it's kind of such a nice place. You know, practically speaking, you know, everybody gets sufficient rest, everybody gets sufficient, you know, bhoga, you know, whatever medical things are there in whatever part of the world one's in, you know, this kind of allows people to take advantage of as much as we practically can, whatever type of medical system we want. You know, there's a lot to be done as an organization as far as creating more, you know, hospice care or senior nursing facility and stuff like that. But that's just more that we're able to, to bite into. In other words, there's a limited service for someone with the capacity of, like, Yudhisthira Maharaj, they could come to ISKCON and they could actually make stuff like that happen. because of their, you know, their greatness, their capacity to serve. But all of us, you know, we have the opportunity to do as much as we want for Guru and Krishna. We can hear as much as we want. We can chant as much as we want. We can remember. We can come and take help, get as much help from the devotees anytime we need it. Oh, I'm having a hard time. You know, my mind is disturbed for whatever reason. I need to remember Krishna. You know, maybe I can do some, maybe I can do this for Krishna. You know, there's like a limited service all over the world. You know, and that's a whole other thing that, you know, one can live all over the world. Of course, you know, we're limited by our own capacity, but, you know, that we have to be progress enough to at least recognize that. Well, the reason I don't go to Austria to live is because it would be very difficult for me to go to Austria to live in a temple. You know, where it is, you know, where I'm at right now is like the easiest thing I could do. But if I wanted to move to Dallas, you know, that would be within my capacity, perhaps, or Houston, or even Atlanta. And so, you know, there's unlimited possibility of, and that, and within our capacity of what we can, how we can serve Guru and Krishna. And simply be happy in Krishna consciousness until our last days of, you know, trying to remember Krishna. You know, my practical experience, the few devotees I've seen leaving the world, they were all trying to remember Krishna to various degrees. And from my external vision, they seem to meet with, you know, a lot of success in that regard. So that way that, you know, reconfirms in our minds and hearts that the process of surrendering to Krishna, especially towards the end of life, just giving everything up and just throwing ourselves into His service rather than taking the opportunity for 10 or 15 years of sense gratification where we don't have to work for anyone but we can collect some pension and simply do whatever we want to do, you know. We, you know, one who is transcendental, what they'll want to do is serve Krishna, Guru and Krishna. Okay? Shri Prabhupada and Jaya.